So this is our background for this episode, huh? I wonder if this will change once we get into court. The curiosity shop. Get some more toilet paper!
Windebanks upon brokery.
That is like the most British combination of words. Or English. It's not British. I don't know where London is. Hey, Gina Lestrade. Also, hello everybody. Welcome back to the Great Ace Attorney Chronicles. In the last episode, we started case 5 and met back up with Gina Lestrade. I have a feeling. I have a hunch. I think she's going to be the defendant. Converse. Pawnbroker's customer. Somehow, I didn't really think you were the sort of person who would use a pawnbroker, Miss Lestrade.
Yeah, well, I am, all right. I'm a Londoner, just like everyone else. That a problem, is it?
No, not at all. It's just that, well...
Oh, I get it. I know what you're thinking. That thing probably don't even belong to her. Probably got her on the dive, didn't she? Yeah, I can see her right all over your Chevy Chase.
Well, I might have been thinking something along those lines.
You're not gonna deny it. You're not gonna deny it, Mr. Narihodo?
No. Alright then, I'm just gonna come out and ask you straight. Do you pawn things that you steal from other people?
Well, I don't know how best to answer that, really.
Suppose. Sometimes. You're not gonna deny it either, Miss Lestrade?
But not this time, alright? I swear, that thing belongs to me.
The disc that Mr. Winnebank is holding? Perhaps we should see what he has to say about all this. Oh, that's it? Oh, great music.
Oh, gosh! Oh, no! Oh, Miss Lestrade's disc!
Mr. Winnebank, what exactly is this metal disc that Miss Lestrade has brought in? It seems to have hundreds of tiny little bumps on its surface.
Ah, this is a music disc, you see, for use inside a music box.
In a music box?
What, you don't even know what a music box is? Your Eastern lot ain't too savvy, eh?
I know what a music box is. I've just never seen one of these discs before.
The small protrusions on the metal disc encode the tune to be played by the music box. You simply insert the disc and set the machine going, and beautiful music plays.
It's so incredible! Tell us, what tune is on this disc?
Well, I'm afraid I couldn't tell you that. There are so many different types of music box, you see. British made, German, Swiss. I have no way of knowing which particular machine this disc was made for.
Ah, I see.
And that's it in a nutshell. I wouldn't have any customers for an item like this, even if the young lady forfeited it. Really, I'm already offering more than I should at a penny.
That's a packet of lies! He told me he did! He said it was... well...
He? Who?
Oh, man!
Never you mind! It just ain't right, that's all! That disc's worth good money, I know it is!
Well, then, you'll have to try your luck at another pawnbroker's, won't you?
Ah! Oh, she's getting mad.
She's been in here before, of course, this little tatterdemalion.
What in the world? You just made that up. There's no way. Tatterdemalion.
A person dressed in ragged clothing. And they're a supervillain in the Marvel Universe. They look really cool. Oh my god. Let me get a look at this guy. Whoa! Huh. Okay, anyway. I'm just gonna assume that I'm pronounced. I would be surprised if we saw that word again.
I see.
And brought some dubious article or other with her every single time, I might add.
Dubious? What are you trying to say? I'm an honest customer, me!
So, is there something dubious about the disc she brought in today?
Well, if only it were that simple.
Sorry, what do you mean?
What she actually brought in was a storage ticket.
I don't know what kind of accent to give this guy. Ah, a storage ticket. So Miss Lestrade has actually come to redeem an article from you. Has actually come to redeem an article from you today. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. A girl like me has a lot of stuff what needs storing.
Alright, yes, that's definitely dubious.
The article in question would have been forfeited at midnight tonight. But as she gave me the ticket for it and repaid both the loan and the interest, I was obliged to return the article to her.
But what was the article? What was the article? Do tell us, Mr. Windibank. That's some confidential.
The little scamp is wearing it, ma'am. It's the overcoat that she redeemed.
Was she not wearing that in case 3?
Oh.
What? What's wrong with that? It fits, don't it? I mean, it's mine, so of course it does.
So, what about the disc then? How does that come into all this?
The disc is something else. A new article to pawn, if the girl and I can agree a price.
I'm confused. I thought you said that Miss Lestrade brought in a storage ticket today.
It's really quite simple. Yes, the child brought me a storage ticket, and the money owed on it, as you say.
For this heavy black coat, which you returned to her care, as I'd understood it.
Ryunosuke, this isn't that complicated. She came to get something back and put something in. It's not rocket science.
That's right, yes. And rather unsurprisingly, as soon as the little ragamuffin put the thing on, she went rifling through the pockets.
Oh, you mean...
What? Don't you know it's rude to stare at a lady?
Ah, I see. I love how she looks off to the side when she does that pose. It's like her version of Ryunosuke's himbo pose. She's just like, oh! Like looking off to the side. This came, someone came from the pocket of the overcoat, did it?
If you mean this disc, then yes, exactly, ma'am.
And she immediately tried to pawn it for quite a high price as well. This is all rather suspicious, I think.
Give it up. I'm just trying to pawn something like anything else, like anyone else would.
Well, but if it was in the pocket, then...
Miss Lestrade, may I ask who deposited the overcoat here in the first place?
Well, me.
It doesn't really appear to be your size.
Me old man! It's me old man's, ain't it?
Is it Miss Lestrade?
Yes, this is definitely all rather suspicious.
I can't get a beat on some of her line readings. Out of my way, please!
Who's that? Who the fuck are you? Who's this picture postcard English gentleman? I know what kind of voice to give this guy.
I think.
Good day to you, ladies. Gentlemen.
Oh, suspicious folk.
What's your problem, eh?
There is no problem, as long as you remove yourself. If I have a matter to discuss with the proprietor. And if you intend to make a problem of it, I shall see you outside, little girl, for the hiding you deserve.
Look, ain't it obvious? I ain't done talking with him yet. If you think you're such a gent, you should know how to wait in line.
Well, you are an impudent little brat, aren't you? As well as a pickpocket.
Eh? Who are you? I don't know who I am.
The question is, how do you not know who I am? You haven't the courtesy even to remember the faces of your victims, it seems.
What? You mean I... from you?
I need to go higher pitched with this guy's voice.
Broker? Yes, sir? I believe this filthy pocket thief has just redeemed an article from you, no? Yes, the article in question belongs to me. I demand for it to be returned at once.
Oh my! Now that's a lie! What are you trying to pull?
Give me back my overcoat, you wastrel, and needless to say... Any music box discs, too.
No! You can't have it! You just can't! It's me old man's! Or it was! Now it's mine!
Goodness, Mr. Nakahodo. This is a very awkward situation.
Yes, I think perhaps we should hear both sides of the story in a little more detail.
The gentleman's accusation.
Miss Lestrade, is what the gentleman is saying...
What do you think? It's all lies, ain't it? Obviously. I swear on my life, I ain't never laid eyes on that dandy before.
Let's hear it now, you little ragamuffin. You stole it, didn't you? That ticket you brought in here just now.
No, I swear it. I swear to God.
It was barely an hour ago. I was walking along the street, minding my own business, when this little gutterling ran into me. I knew at once what had happened. I've been robbed yet again, I thought to myself. Those wretched pickpockets.
Yet again?
Oh yes, as you can see, I'm a man of impeccable style. This isn't the first time that I've been targeted by these back slum scoundrels. Now then, relinquish my overcoat. Come along now, Miss Lestrade, give the good gentleman his coat back. If you're going to cause trouble, I shall have no choice but to call the police.
Hold on, why does everyone think it's me? Just look at this dandy cove, and you think I'm the dodgy one?
I must say, the overcoat doesn't fit him at all.
I'm sorry, but no one's gonna believe you.
Well, what about evidence? Yeah. Where's your evidence that I've stolen something, eh? Go on, let's see it.
Oh, I have evidence, naturally.
You what? Oh, no.
Evidence that the article Miss Lestrade redeemed actually belongs to this gentleman.
Of course! We need only consult Mr. Windebank's ledger to know the truth. We'll be able to look up the name of the person who deposited the article in the first place. Yes! Brilliant!
I'm very sorry, but I'm afraid that won't be possible.
Oh?
I never ask customers' names. That's a strict policy of mine.
But why not?
Well now, as you can imagine, some of my customers have circumstances to consider. A great many of them prefer to maintain their anonymity.
Yes, I see.
But then, how can you know if an article belongs to the person asking to redeem it?
Oh, it's quite simple.
So happy.
Good sir, might I trouble you for the watchword associated with the article in question? Of course, it's... Professor. Yes, that's right. And all the evidence we need. This gentleman is the rightful owner of the article, without doubt.
A watchword? Interesting. Well, do you have those written down? Well, I guess that wouldn't tie it to an identity to a person. That's clever. Yeah, that is clever. I like that. So, about these watchwords, Mr. Windybank.
As I just explained, I never ask customers' names when they deposit items with me. There are many reasons why. Certain customers would like to keep their activities secret.
That's how I gotta do this voice. I just have to tilt my chin up like he does, and then I can get the right kind of voice cracks. That wasn't exactly a subtle glance at Mr. Sholmes now, was it?
Great detectives have no dark secrets. None at all.
Yes, well, anyway, that's why I always ask for a watchword whenever I accept a new article. In many ways, it's like the secret combination of numbers used to unlock a vault. The date of deposit, a description, and a watchword. Uniquely identify each item. And of course, then I give the storage ticket to the customer. When someone comes to redeem something, I ask for the ticket and the watchword.
And if that someone tells you the correct watchword, you return the article?
That's right, sir. Yes, just as soon as the requisite fee is paid.
Wait, so how did... Oops.
And I have supplied you with the information you require already, but for the avoidance of doubt, the article in question is an overcoat, deposited 2 months ago on 15th February. With a watchword of Professor. All perfectly correct information, sir.
But how?
Really, this is beyond a joke. This is beyond a joke now. There is no further room for doubt.
She wasn't lying. Man, there's no way she's lying. What's gonna happen? Is the fifth case really gonna be about something like this? Or is somebody gonna die? Now what? Oh, now we talked to him. Okay.
Picture postcard, gentlemen.
Excuse me, but who are you?
One would expect the inquirer to introduce himself first. Though clearly you are not British, so perhaps our ways are foreign to you.
Oh, sorry. Yes, we're from the Empire of Japan. We're studying here.
Oh, yes, Japan. I've heard talk of the place.
Yeah, it's Disco Kid. Its inhabitants live on some fiery, brown-colored soup dressed up with exotic spices.
You might be thinking of somewhere else. And what was that theatrical gesticulation about?
Perhaps. Anyway, if you are a gentleman, sir, you offer your own name first before inquiring after the name of another.
Of course, yes. I'm Ryunosuke Naruhodo. I'm a lawyer. Well, a student of law, really.
My name is Susato Mikotoba. I am Mr. Naruhodo's assistant.
I see. My name is Benedict. Yes. Egert Benedict.
Egg boy? Who would vote for him?
Enchanté.
He's so refined in how he holds himself and how he speaks, but that name is suspicious.
Egert Benedict. That is so stupid. Now to the matter at hand.
My overcoat! Return it at once! To someone with the style to carry it off.
Every move he makes, every breath he takes, I can't stand watching him.
Okay, no, yeah, okay, fair enough. It doesn't go with the hat, but...
So, let that be an end to the matter. And thank you for your custom, Mr. Egert Benedict, sir.
Who is this guy?
With such reasonable rates of interest, I may even decide to come back.
This is why I hate grown-ups. Just because I'm a diver, everyone thinks that makes me a liar.
And the contents of the coat pockets, if you please, broker. But of course, sir, here is the disc for you. Just this one? Pardon, sir? I was expecting another. That is, I deposited another.
Another disc?
Oh dear. I regret to inform you, sir. That was what was deposited with me was merely the overcoat. The disc happened to be in one of the pockets, but I was completely unaware of it until now. So, Gutterling, you're hiding more of what's rightfully mine, are you?
Says who, eh? I don't know nothing about it.
Very well. Then I shall bid you farewell. Say goodbye to style.
Wait a minute. That disc is mine.
Oh, jeez.
What do you think you're doing, you little tramp? You've drawn blood, you filthy animal.
Oh my, yes, there's blood on the disc.
It's because of all those sharp little bumps. The man must have scratched his finger on them.
I found it first, all right? I mean, it belonged to me, old man. So you're not having it. Or you take it.
Me?
If I hang on to it, they'll have it off me again. So you keep hold of it.
Miss Lestrade, why is this disc so important to her?
Why am I just taking it?
You there, in the Black Library, hand the disc to me at once, please.
No, don't. He's lying. Grown-ups are all liars.
Ugh, what do I do now? How am I gonna resolve this? Hey, dude. Mr. Windermake is clearly at a loss here. We have to do something about this before he reaches up for that revolver of his. Is Sholmes here? Hey, dude, what's up? Help me out here. Mr. Sholmes, what are you examining with such keen interest there? As you enjoy a bar of caramel, I see. What's up, dude?
So, you found me at last, Mr. Naruhodo.
Sorry?
After that young pickpocket sent me on my way, I was forced to lurk in the shadows. Cruelly ostracized as the rest of you are partaking in the jovial atmosphere of fellowship. I had nothing to occupy my mind but was too ashamed to let society see what my downfall had done to me. So, feigning mock interest, I pretended to examine the tedious trinkets in this desolate place. Whilst, as you shrewdly observed, gnawing on the only friend I have left, this 7% solution of caramel.
Are you okay?
Pray, do you claim to understand the depths of my despair, Mr. Naruhodo? But how could you? I was so lonely, so desperately lonely.
Then why on earth didn't you rejoin the conversation?
Things have gone from bad to worse here, you know.
Yes, I overheard much of your conversation. Or rather, in my craving for human contact, my ears devoured every word that was uttered.
You really were sad, weren't you?
Poor Mr. Sholmes, I feel simply awful for you. It would seem that my inferences are correct.
Oh, surely you're not about to tell. Oh, we gotta do the dance of deduction. We gotta do the dance of deduction, don't we? Oh my god, that you've solved the entire case once again?
My dear madam, sometimes I wonder, were my genius for deduction to be commoditized? How much could I pawn it for?
It seems Mr. Sholmes has had another of his flashes of inspiration, but who knows if it'll help to resolve the situation between Miss Lestrade and the mysterious gentleman. What's the right thing to do here? Oh, come on, we gotta!
Well, Miss Lestrade, it would appear you find yourself in something of a predicament.
Tch! Where the blue blazes have you been, eh?
Pardon?
When a lady's in trouble, a tree gent's supposed to be there to help. Straight away! Not an hour later! He falls over. Harsh. Stop posing, fucking...
And who, pray tell, are you? Mr. Egbert Benedict. You have, in my eyes, a veritably encyclopedic array of curiosities about your person. Nevertheless, there are two immovable conclusions I have drawn. I beg your pardon. The first is this. The true reason for your visit to this pawnbrokery today is something you have not yet revealed.
Oh, shit.
And the second is this. A considerable crime is in contemplation. One, you will orchestrate with intent to steal a vast sum of money. Well, Mr. Benedict, what say you to my deductions?
How? Oh, you bastard, you dumb shit. Why would you admit that? He's turned as white as a hard-boiled egg. It would seem that once again, Mr. Sholmes has made a flawless deduction.
Just who do you think you are, sir? Ah, yes, as I hoped. That is precisely the pained expression I was looking for.
All right, let's do it. Let's do it, man.
So, shall we begin? The time has come for yet another of Herlock Sholmes' Logic and Reasoning Spectacular.
Mystery Man's Aim.
First of all, we must ask ourselves on what business you ventured to this pawnbrokery today. You claim to have followed this pickpocket here, having had the redemption ticket stolen from you on the street. But that is most certainly a lie. The real truth is something quite different.
Oh gee, I wonder. What is that?
As revealed by that which you hold in your hand. Yes, what brought you to this shop in the first place is the staff recruitment flyer.
What?
The piece of paper in your hand is a staff wanted advertisement from this very shop. Yet even the most unobservant would soon realize that a man of your appearance has no need of such employ. In other words, there is some ulterior motive for your actions.
Exclamation mark.
The cane, which you unwittingly clutch to your person, exhibits an incontrovertible contradiction. What utter rot! I've had this cane for years! The contradiction of which I speak is, of course, the missing ferrule. The end of any walking cane should be terminated with a metal ferrule to protect the wooden tip. And yet detailed analysis shows the wooden tip of this stick to be utterly bare. Therefore, there is only one conclusion. The rod that you hold in your hand is royal blue, which appears to be a walking cane, is in fact no cane at all!
It's a sword. It's one of those sword canes. He's gonna kill the guy.
You recoil, sir. Is something wrong? I... And in your recoiling, you inadvertently facilitate the answer of the next conundrum to present itself. Namely, what is the truth behind this rod you bear? Yes, your reaction betrays the truth. The handle, which you evidently would like to conceal, is the key to understanding this riddle, you see. From the moment I saw it, my suspicions were aroused. What walking cane demands such a stout handle? Mused I. But of course, as I said, this is no walking cane. No, that rod... What? It's a shovel! It's the broken handle of a shovel! What? Are you insane? And now, having determined this undeniable truth, the conclusion is clear. Your true motive for coming here is to dig up a body. Was to take employment at this establishment in order to excavate the ground beneath the premises. What a calculated crime you have conceived, sir. A wickedly calculated crime. You are on crack, boy. To tunnel underneath the pawn brokery. Now, Mr. Benedict, let us continue. For we must expose the details of this elaborate crime you have in the planning. This is utterly absurd. You suggest that I, a gentleman, intend to excavate the ground beneath this pawnbrokery with a broken shovel? What on earth do you propose I could expect to find there? Ooh, whoa! Some long-forgotten treasure, I suppose. Save for such a fanciful theory. Fanciful theory? What possible reason could I have to do as you say? Oh, but there is ample reason. As you are only too well aware, Mr. Benedict. Ah, and your furtive glance is more telling than I could have hoped. What? Let us consider what would motivate a man to infiltrate a shop such as this and covertly dig beneath its floor. The answer is revealed by the council notice on the counter to which your eyes were inadvertently drawn. This letter gives notice of public works to be carried out in the local area. And according to the enclosed plan of the upcoming sewerage works, beneath this shop runs a sewer that adjoins another. One that runs under the bank of the opposite side on the opposite side of the road. This madness has entered the sewers now, has it? By excavating the ground beneath our feet, you would gain access to the waterway that flows in very close proximity to the great vault of the financial institution opposite. What are you... In summary, sir... Spain! You devised a master plan to pull off an elaborate bank robbery by dint of the underground tunnels! Master plan? Spain! Which brings us at last to the final chapter of this lurid scheme. With what plunder did the thief hope to make off from the underground vault of the bank? Are you quite serious? Having consulted with Scotland Yard some days ago, I happen to know the answer. But naturally, the answer is no secret to you, is it, Mr. Benedict? Ha 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 ha! I have no idea what you're talking about. Allow me to present a rather interesting piece of evidence. You see, this picture postcard tells us all we need to know. What? The postcard of the Great Exhibition. I'm afraid you've quite lost me. Currently in the final stages of preparation, the Great Exhibit will soon be underway. And the government has provided extra funds to complete its centerpiece, the Crystal Tower. Funds that currently sit in the vault of the bank on the other side of this road. Pardon? Yes, the considerable crime you have been contemplating is the theft of that which sits in the vault of that bank. The special reserve funds for the Great Exhibition. The Federal Reserve Bank. Of course, that is top secret police information. So keep it under your hat, please. What a dillweed. Good lord. Thus concludes Paralogue Shome's great deduction of this pawnbroking puzzle. Are you high? The girl is really high up there in the picture. Mr. Sholmes. Well, Mr. Natterhodo, an impressively upbeat deduction for an attack of racked with loneliness, would you not agree?
Was it true what you said about the bank over the road and what it has in its vault?
Indeed. Though few know of its existence, it is one of the government's most closely guarded secrets. Gregson told me, in the strictest confidence.
But you just announced it to everyone here. Rather loudly, in fact. And if it's such a big secret, how would Mr. Benedict have come to find out about it?
There can be but one explanation for that. Clearly it is because the man is a criminal.
But what if he didn't know anything about the money in the vault? If he is a criminal, as you said, then buying a brand new shovel is sure to be the first thing he does now that you've revealed the secret. Oh. Or if he doesn't, maybe Mr. Windebank will. He already has plenty of shovels here, after all.
Oh, my life! I assure you I'm not so unscrupulous. Well, hopefully this has taught you a valuable lesson. Sensitive information must be handled with the utmost of care.
What a dumb shit. One can never be sure that someone privy to secrets won't disclose them. And once the word is out, it's out. Perhaps I'll think twice before confiding in you next time, Mr. Sholmes.
An excellent idea, Mr. Naruhodo. An excellent idea.
Well then, Mr. Naruhodo, you know what to do, I'm sure.
Yes, let's listen to that great deduction again. And see if we can massage it into shape.
Very well then. Let us start once more from the beginning. Of Herlock Sholmes, magnificent. Logic and reasoning, spectacular.
Alright, let's do it.
Spam!
Course correction! Holy, Mr. Sholmes!
Okay, so this is stupid. He is a fool, yes he is. First of all, we must ask ourselves on what business you mentioned this promogree today. I haven't the foggiest, like, ugh. Is there something on the back of that, maybe? Or maybe the cane itself?
So, by Mr. Sholmes' reasoning, Mr. Benedict came here in order to apply for a job so he could dig down through the floor.
Yes, in an attempt to tunnel into the sewers to gain access to the money in the vault of the bank across the road. But he wouldn't get very far with a broken shovel, would he?
No, I think it's fair to say his motives lie elsewhere.
The question is, where?
What did bring Mr. Benedict here at this particular point in time?
Scribbled writing. Hello, that looks like a picture of Gina Lestrade.
Oh, look at all the scribbled notes on the back of the flyer here.
I don't believe it! What is it? Listen to what it says. Name, Gina Lestrade. Height, 5'2". Green cap, scruffy waistcoat, grubby white shirt. Blue satchel, ragged. It's a detailed description of Miss Lestrade. Goodness! There's even a sketch of her, hat and all. Although, if he showed it to her, she'd fire that smoke grenade launcher in his face for sure. And look, the details of the shop have been written down here, too. Windebank's Pawnbrokery, Baker Street, redemption deadline, 15th April. Which is today's date!
Why would Mr. Benedict have all that information scrawled on the back of that piece of paper?
Well, gee, I wonder. Info about Miss Lestrade.
Okay, well, it's gotta be that.
Take that!
Yes, what brought you to this shop in the first place is the info about Miss Lestrade.
Quite so, my dear fellow. It would appear that the writing and sketch on the reverse of the flyer pertain to the pickpocket Miss Lestrade and to Mr. Windebank's pawnbrokery here.
You originally told us... Man, she's so cute. That you had merely given chase after Miss Lestrade stole the redemption ticket from you.
But that, sir, is a thinly veiled lie.
Oh, she's good and mad.
It is the information on the back of the flyer that led you here today. By which I mean...
Man, that smirk is so...
Here, to the Windebank's pawnbrokery, and today, the redemption...
Hang on, what did he say before?
By which I mean, here, to the Windebank's pawnbrokery, and today, the redemption deadline of that overcoat.
So, you waited outside for the young girl matching the description you have written down to arrive.
and you have gone to some lengths to hide the reason for your pursuit of Miss Lestrade. In other words, there is some ulterior motive for your actions. Exclamation mark. The cane, which you unwittingly clutch to your person, exhibits an incontrovertible contradiction.
What utter rot! I've had this cane for years.
Is of course.
God, that reminds me of this fan fiction I wrote as a kid, where it was Lemmy and Iggy playing video games on the couch, and they had a babysitter coming over, and Bowser left the house without, and none of them noticed that he left, and then, like, right after he left, Iggy is like, Lemmy! And he points at the door where Bowser just left, and he pauses for, like, 5 seconds before swinging his hand to point over at the oven to say, our lasagna's burning!
What's a ferrule? It's the metal cap commonly found on the end of a cane, Mr. Nadehodo. Ah, the bit that makes the nice clacking sound on the pavement. Yes, exactly. And Mr. Sholmes is right, it appears to be missing on this cane. But it doesn't actually look broken, does it? No, it doesn't.
Those gentlemen certainly did recoil when Mr.
There's one secret about the cane, which may be why we don't know.
Speed! Speed! Okay. Probably the initials. Because they certainly don't say E-E-B. Ectobiologist. Look here, Miss Susato. There are some letters on the handle. At first, this guy's name is Eggert, and then his initials are E-B. The Homestuck references just don't stop, even though that was Eggbert. Ah, yes, those must be initials, I think. In the West, it's customary for people to engrave their belongings with the first letters of their names. So Herlock Sholmes would be HS, you mean? Another Homestuck replicate! That's right! And the initials on this cane, obviously. Oh. AG. Why does it feel as though that's not quite right?
Take that!
Ain't your cane, bitch! Mary in a biatch, having 7 key odds.
A most astute observation, wouldn't you say, Mr. Eggert Benedict?
Exclamation mark.
We are led to believe, sir, that your initials are E.B. Yet in a most possessive manner, you have in your grasp a cane bearing the initials A.G.
Well, ectobiologists and arachnid's group did have kind of a thing going on there for a while.
An incontrovertible contradiction indeed, would you not agree? No, you're wrong. This cane isn't...
You said before that you'd had that cane for years.
It's been!
So don't try to tell us that you just borrowed it from a friend or found it in the park.
In short, though you hold yourself to be a gentleman, you have withheld your true name!
Oh, really? What was that sound?
You recoil, sir. Is something wrong?
I...
And in your recoiling, you inadvertently facilitate the answer of the next conundrum to present itself. Namely, what is the truth behind this rod you bear?
It's amazing that they managed to write this in a way where it makes sense when he's totally wrong, and it still makes sense when you're on the right track. Like, he's saying the same stuff here, the secret behind the rod that you bear, but it still makes sense because the rod is hiding the secret of what his actual name is.
Yes, your reaction betrays the truth. The handle, which you evidently would like to conceal, is the key to understanding this riddle, you see.
What? Okay, no, I guess not. Let's consider the bare bones of what's happened here. Miss Lestrade redeemed that fine-looking overcoat. And now a mysterious man has appeared, introducing himself with a fake name, and claiming that the overcoat belongs to him. But we know that he actually identified Miss Lestrade from a written description, which suggests that everything else he's told us is untrue. So what we need to do here is somehow prove that the overcoat cannot possibly belong to him.
Split seam. it's too small for him.
Oh, the seam on the shoulder there is coming apart. It's coming apart, look. So it is. Do you know, a moment ago when Mr. Benedict was surprised with something that was said.
Oh, I heard that. I thought I heard him make a rather strange noise. It sounded a bit like a tiny growl.
But now I think it was probably the sound of the seam ripping open. If you look closely, it does seem to be a very tight fit. The sleeves are stretched to bursting, and he wouldn't have a hope of fastening it at the front. If you were to run around in it, I'm sure the whole thing would fall apart.
That I'd like to see.
Sorry? So how can we make Mr. Benedict run around? She's really giving this some thought. Okay, well, that's obviously it. It's not his.
Take that!
But what does that have to do with his name? I thought we were trying to figure out his name. The split seam, which you evidently would like to conceal, is the key to understanding this riddle, you see. Wait, but he wouldn't have reacted to that before. Yes, because the overcoat is rather obviously a poor fit. Having forced it over your broad shoulders, the seam is already breaking apart. My suspicions were aroused from the outset. When you so baldly lied about your name and so boldly waylaid this pickpocket. Ugh! This catalog of untruths has all been for one very specific purpose. To steal the article that the young girl redeemed from Mr. Windebank. But what really irks me is this. The considerable crime I initially imagined has been considerably curtailed. Curtailed? Wait, so is he gonna need to come up with a whole other... to come up with a whole second shitty deduction? Now, Mr. Benedict, let us continue. For we must expose the details of this elaborate crime you have been planning, except that, wait, he's... This is utterly absurd, especially that he... You suggest that I, a gentleman, designed a wheeze to filch some tawdry article of pawnage? Have you forgotten that I redeemed the article in the proper manner using the watchword? So, I'm gonna punch ya. Had I not been the one to deposit it in the first place, how could I possibly have known the relevant details, n'est-ce pas? Oh, but the watchword can be discovered. As you are only too well aware, Mr. Benedict. Oh, it's right there. That would be written in the ledger. Ah, and your furtive glance is more telling than I could have hoped. What? I think this guy is supposed to be French, actually. Let us consider how one might come to learn a secret watchword relating to the pawned property of another. The method is revealed by the council notice on the counter to which your eyes were inadvertently drawn. Sholmes, are you listening to what you're saying? The direction of the deduction must change rather dramatically now, I think. Yes, no more talk of tunneling into the sewers. Which is a pity, because it all sounded rather exciting. Anyway, you can't deny that this mysterious gentleman did know the watchword. Yes, Professor. If he didn't know that word, Mr. Windebank would never allow you to redeem the article. Well, how would she... See, the question I have is like, well, how did she take it out? Unless she knew it. So surely, you know, if you trust, you know, for Windebank to trust that Eggert Benedict is the true owner of it because he knew the watchword, surely that same thing would extend to Gina too. Or looking at the other way, if you did know that word, Mr. Windebank would allow you to redeem the article whether it was yours or not. So the question is, could this gentleman have found the watchword out somehow? Who were you expecting? The Thuth Fairy? Ledger? No? Okay. Who were you expecting? The Thuth Fairy? Enough said. Ledger. Look at this, Mrs. Otto. Ah, it appears to be a memo that Mr. Windebank has scribbled to himself. Let's see, what does it say? Oh! Professor! That's it? Mr. Windebank must make a note of the watchwords his customers give him, right before their eyes. And an alarmingly clear script as well. Oh dear, I don't know where to look! Who knows what other secrets I might see? Well, does it say what it matches? What it goes with? Old lamp! This looks to be quite an old lamp, but it's obviously been well looked after, and there's oil in it too. In other words, it's still in use. Yes, it would appear so. But as for how it could be related to Mr. Benedict knowing the watchword for the pond article, I have no idea. That makes two of us. I'm gonna present it.
Take that!
Old lamp! Oh, wait, no, it just doesn't do anything. This lamp may be old, but it's still in... Oh, I didn't know it was gonna damage me! It didn't show my health, so I didn't know it was gonna hurt me. And it's been polished until it gleams. Somehow, by some inexplicable physical phenomenon, the watchword was reflected in the glass chimney. and you read it with your superhuman eyesight. It's the only logical explanation.
What precisely was your intention with that, Mr. Natohodo?
Just following the natural progression of the deduction. Sometimes the truth hurts.
Well, the truth is, you do not have a turn for observation or deduction. Did that hurt?
Yes, a lot. Don't play all the... Holy God. Holy God. Okay. Oh my God. Holy fucking shit. You're really gonna make me...
I just thought it would be funny, man. You didn't need to give me the whole rigmarole.
The notelet. That sounds like a piece of gum.
The method is revealed by the notelet on the counter to which your eyes were inadvertently drawn. Yes, the broker here follows the same procedure whenever a customer comes to redeem an article. He asks the customer for the watchword, and notes down the response uttered on a notelet he has to hand. Then he consults his ledger and confirms whether or not the watchword matches that of the article in question.
I would expect nothing less of a diligent pawnbroker.
But his diligence clearly has its disadvantages.
What are you talking about?
It is increasingly apparent that you were present in this shop before your accusation against Miss Lestrade.
In all likelihood, you followed her inside and then observed her talking to Mr. Windebank. When the diligent broker made a note of the watchword, as is his common practice, you observed him writing the word professor on the notelet beside the ledger. !
And that, sir,
was the master plan you devised to steal the pawned article from the young Miss Lestrade.
Master plan!
Which brings us at last to the final chapter of this lurid scheme. Why would you go to such lengths to redeem that particular article from this pawnbroker?
Are you quite serious?
For an ill-fitting overcoat hardly seems to justify the effort, much less the worthless music box disc. But naturally, you had very good reason to make them yours, didn't you, Mr. Benedict?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Allow me to present a rather interesting piece of evidence. You see, this picture postcard tells us all we need to know.
What? Eh?
The articles we're talking about are the overcoat and the music box disc that was in one of the pockets, which according to Mr. Windebank isn't even worth a penny. And yet this man went to such lengths to steal them.
Why?
I wonder if perhaps... We already have the evidence we need to explain it, Mr. Natohodo.
Could we? Really?
I'd better have a thorough look through all the evidence we've collected so far.
Yeah. Wow, we sure have a lot of options.
Oh, shit. What does that say?
Oh my God! It says, oh my God! Oh, man!
There's a little scrap paper stuck onto the reverse side of the disc, look. And a scribbled word or two. It looks like somebody's name.
Oh, is that what it's gonna be? This fifth case? Maybe that's what it's gonna be. Maybe there isn't gonna be a murder in this case, but we're gonna figure out what happened to Mr. McGilded.
For McGilded?
McGilded? It couldn't be.
But it is, Mr. Natohodo. A name I shall never forget for as long as I live.
But why? Why is his name on this?
Whoa.
Review scene.
Huh. Don't present the armband.
What's that on the back? On the back, it reads, for McGilded.
Man, I miss you, dude.
Ah, Mr. Magnus McGilded, the unfortunate philanthropist who perished in curious circumstances at the Old Bailey 2 months ago. A prominent man in London, though his loan mongering demonstrated a distinct lack of scruples.
You know, exploiting rich people, I can think of worse ways to, you know, get rich enough to be a philanthropist.
So, you're an associate of his, are you? Or perhaps a subordinate?
Mr. McGilded was a man of unusually small stature. In fact, he was precisely the right size for that overcoat that you've squeezed yourself into. Your true identity remains shrouded in mystery, Mr. Eggert Benedict. But the final conclusion here is crystal clear. The reason you came to this pawnbrokery today... Spiel! ...was to retrieve an article left behind by the late Magnus McGilded. To acquire an item deposited by Mr. McGilded. Man, so even he used this pawnbrokery. Wow. Ah. Just finishing my water. Well, well, Mr. Magnus McGilded. Not a name I expected to hear in these circumstances. Give us the overcoat, motherfucker. Mr. Sholmes, I'm afraid there's something very troubling on my mind. Pray tell, Mrs. Otto. Well, according to what Mr. Windbank told us earlier, today was the final day on which the tote could have been redeemed, was it not? Today is the 15th of April, so 2 months ago today...
Would have been the 15th of February, sir, that's right. It's all carefully recorded in my ledger. Deposited at 10:30 p.m., I see.
What? But that suggests... Yes, 15th of February. Is precisely the day on which the omnibus... Oh, that was when the murder took place. Okay. I didn't remember the exact timeline. I was thinking, wait, when did he... How long ago was that trial? Like, could he still be alive somehow? But no. And 10:30 in the evening is precisely the time at which the terrible events were unfolding? What the hell?
Suggestive is not the word. It would seem the matter is entirely beyond coincidence. You are, of course, at liberty to make whatever outlandish deductions you choose. However...
Oh my god!
I must insist you hand over the music box disc now. It would be a terrible shame for you to return to your native land in a box.
Ah! What do I do? I have a feeling this doesn't matter. Because, I mean, the alternative would be I die, you know? He could shoot me at any moment. I hate to give in, but what other choice do I really have here?
Hold it! Mr. Windebank, this is my shop. I can't allow any harm to come to my customers. If that were to happen, I should have to take my own life.
Mr. Windebank, no! All right, that's enough.
What?
Oh, it's you! What's up, dude? Inspector Gregson!
Inspector?
That's right, Sunshine. The alarm was raised on one of our dedicated emergency lines.
Oh my god! The fucking cameras! So we got here as fast as we could. Now what's all this about, eh?
Oh, praise be! You're here at last! I was moments away from forfeiting my own life at my very own establishment! It would seem you have the upper hand.
Right, you lot have some explaining to do. I don't appreciate being bothered by some petty argy-bargy.
Petty? Mr. Windebank really, really nearly met his end. And so did I!
Yeah, by his own gun, as far as I can tell.
Oh, dear.
And the whole of Britain could meet with its end if I don't get to the bottom of the case I'm supposed to be working on.
What? What on earth is the case, Inspector?
Spare no detail, Gregson.
I might have said a little too much. No matter, it's nothing to do with you lot. Anyway, sir, you're gonna have to come with me down to the station.
But of course, Inspector.
Speed! What? Oh my god! I thought he was going to shoot Gregson there. Oh my god.
There's been a spate of thefts at pawn shops around here recently. So you fitted emergency buttons underneath the counters for brokers to let us know when there's trouble.
Oh, Inspector, I was very worried then for a while. Very worried indeed.
Now then, Mr. Permanently in Mourning.
Oh, yes?
I'll be taking that whatever it is on McGilded's down to the yard, thank you very much. So hand it over.
Oh, yes, of course.
No, don't! Don't give it to him! It's mine, that is! Mine!
I'm sorry, miss. Anything belonging to Mr. McGilded has to be taken in as evidence now.
As evidence? If the police demand something as evidence, my dear fellow, we have no choice but to capitulate. It's all yours, Inspector.
So this is case five is probably gonna be all about figuring out how McGilded died and what happened and what actually happened in the omnibus.
And so we handed Mr. McGilded's disc over to Inspector Gregson, and were summarily turfed out of the shop and onto the street.
Well, that sucks. To be continued?
Yeah, okay. Perfect timing. I'm up to 56 minutes here.
God, I love that music.
Alright. How many save slots do I even have here? 20, okay.
Well, that's gonna do it for this episode. Next time we will figure out what we do next. Oh my god, okay. The first hour or so was pretty, you know, uneventful, but man, it picked up. Oh my god. What happened to Mr. McGilded? Oh my god, I want to find out so badly. I want to find out who did that to my boy. Man, he was so cool. Fuck.